Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews. This time on the program, it's a trailblazer in comedy, Cristela Alonzo.
Oh, and Cristela.
No, forget it. I'm not going, no. You always use these as opportunities to try to set me up with men. No.
I don't do that.
You offered a guy a dowry for me.
Cristela Alonzo is the first Latina to create, produce, and star in her own network sitcom, Cristela. She was the first Latina to star in a Disney Pixar film, Cars 3.
I like a challenge. I call you my senior project.
She's also a headliner in comedy clubs. She's streaming on Netflix.
Realized that as a woman, I wanted to break that glass ceiling, you know? But as a Mexican, I want to clean that too, you know what I mean?
It's Cristela Alonzo on Breaking Barriers and her book, Music to My Years, a mixtape memoir of my years growing up and standing up.
Cristela, welcome to the program.
Hello.
Welcome to our new set.
I've heard this is the new set.
We are very fancy now, and we're happy to have you as our first guest on the new set.
You know, my birthday was a week ago, and I feel like this is a gift.
It is a gift for you. It really is great to have you here. I'm really enjoying your book, enjoying the Netflix special, Lower Classy, both obviously funny, but as I was telling you before, I was really touched by it. I think many people don't realize that you grew up in San Juan, Texas, mm-hmm. and you were squatting in a diner. Your whole family, you were squatters.
Yes.
And then now you're here in Hollywood and you're killing it. How did that happen?
Just buy the book. You know, it was so funny. Growing up in a border town, I didn't realize that my childhood was actually coming with a lot of lessons that I don't think a lot of children get. Mm. I come from a mixed status family. So which means that my mom and my oldest brother were undocumented. They were trying to become citizens for a long time. My brother finally became a citizen. It took him over 30 years, you know? And when that happened, I'm first generation Mexican American. And as a kid, I really had to grow up fast mm. to help my mom deal with family life. And I didn't realize that I was actually really falling in love with what I was learning about this culture, because I had to learn about American culture and teach my mom the American culture.
Yeah.
And as I was teaching it to her, I fell in love with it. Mm. And I fell in love with a lot of aspects of it. A lot of it had to do with performance, yeah. because I would have to translate things for my mom. So, you know, we love novelas, like the telenovelas. So we would watch the American soap operas, and then I would act out the American soap operas for my mom so that she knew what was happening. And that was one of the first things that I learned to do to make her laugh. Yeah. She would laugh at how serious I was
right.
in saying things in English, you know, and then in Spanish. And accidentally, just trying to inform my mom really made me fall in love with this thing that I thought, let's go try it. I mean, what's the worst that can happen? I go back to being a squatter.
Right.
I mean, I'm already a squatter. I know what that life is like. It's weird. I've always said that growing up in extreme poverty made me completely fearless mm. because I had nothing to lose. Right. I didn't have anything to begin with.
But your mother had something to lose. You write in your book about the fact that she begged you when you went off to college in St. Louis not to go.
Yes.
How hard was that?
That was one of the hardest things I've ever done in my life, because I was always I was always the good girl, mm-hmm. and I did everything for her. And I knew that if I could go and really try to do what I wanted to do, that it was going to be good for everybody. And she couldn't understand that it was that her pain at that moment would pay off later. Mm. When you get to see someone who has sacrificed so much for you, crying and telling you not to do something, and you still do it, you feel like you betrayed them. Mm. And that's something that there's certain moments in one's life where you always remember that emotion. You'll always remember that feeling.
Yeah.
That's one of those moments. And
I feel like you're feeling it right now.
Yeah, you know, it because it was such a pure moment that it resonates with me, but I know that not a lot of people go through that. Mm. And that's part of what I think has given me the opportunity to be in this business and tell stories like that.
Yeah.
Because they're very specific stories that not everybody can maybe relate to, but the overall emotion of it is something that's super relatable and familiar.
Yeah.
And I know that that story, that situation for my life stands out, and I like to tell people things about my life that they maybe not know about, and maybe at the end of the day realize that we have a lot more in common.
Yeah. At a time when we seem more further apart than ever. You've said about your sitcom that through it you wanted us to know your mom.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't realize that till later, but tell me about that. What the process of making yourself in this sitcom somehow tell your mother's story.
Well, you know, to me, I've always told myself that I find myself, my mom passed away in 2002, so I always feel that my job has always been to continue her journey. Mm. And I think it's kind of probably the point of view of an immigrant, where she came here looking for opportunity, and therefore I want to seek out the opportunity that she wanted to come here and initially to do. So for me, the show was a love letter to my mom, you know, and it was interesting because when the show came out, first of all, I never read any of the reviews. Nothing. I couldn't deal with it. I knew mentally I could not handle, people can be vicious. Mm-hmm. And online, people would come to my social media and they would be so critical of the mother character, saying that it was so stereotypical and why does it, and it was so heartbreaking because it was exactly what my mother was like. Mm. So it was this thing where I think a lot of people like to comment on things in a way that's, they're used to commenting about so many things and not taking 1 second to maybe think that that is a real person.
Yeah, this is your mom.
She tried.
Yeah.
Her best,
yeah.
You know, and
yeah.
Sometimes her best wasn't good by some people's standards, but it was great to me.
Yeah, yeah. I'm going to pick up on that in a second, and I want to talk to you about the show, and I know how it was canceled.
Yes.
And I want you to tell folks that story. We're
sure.
going to get to that when we come back.
On the block. Loved them, right? Now, I couldn't afford to see them in concert, right? So I had this fantasy when I was a kid, you know, that I was gonna meet them and they were gonna fall in love with me, right? No joke, you guys, this was the fantasy. Fourth grade. I was gonna be the maid on their tour bus. And I was gonna clean things so good that they were gonna fall in love with me. Like in my head, I thought they were gonna get on the tour bus and they were gonna be like, oh my God, who made that bed right there? You know what I mean?
Cristela Alonzo on Netflix, that's Lower Classy, which you can see right now on Netflix. We were talking about your sitcom a second ago.
Mm-hmm.
And the way it was canceled, you did one season.
Yes, I did.
And how did you find out that your show was canceled?
So I found out I was doing a stand-up tour. I hadn't done stand-up while we were doing the show because I'm the kind of person that likes to focus on one thing. I believe that if you focus on one thing, you do it well.
Mm-hmm.
So we hadn't heard if we were going to get the second season, and I already knew we weren't. So I decided to do this stand-up tour that was basically a thank you tour to everyone that watched the show.
Mm.
You know, and
you knew you weren't because you had already met with executives who signaled that, or?
I had already known because at that point, I had been guest hosting The View for pretty much the entire year that my show was on the air because the network wasn't giving me, wasn't promoting my show. So I figured, well, I'm going to do the promoting myself. Mm-hmm. And I had been on The View to promote my show when it first started. And they started bringing me in. They brought me in as a guest host. And then they started bringing me in more. And what, you know, it kind of eventually became this thing where on hiatus weeks, they're like, do you want to come and do the whole week? And I thought, yes, I mean, we can get word on my show. This is fantastic. So then I noticed that I was meeting people, the higher ups at the network, daytime. And there was one visit where I met the president of daytime. And it felt foreign and it felt weird. And in that meeting, I thought, oh, I think I might get offered this job. I have a sitcom, so I can't do both. Mm-hmm. And I was still holding on because that was my baby. The show was my baby. But I did this stand-up tour to thank everybody that supported the TV show because I remember I wrote an essay about it after. I don't like how in Hollywood when shows are canceled, we treat them like they never existed. Mm-hmm. We just shun them. We put them in a dark room and we lock up the door. And to me, that was the best thing that had happened to me. And how am I going to ignore that? And how am I going to ignore the people that really resonated with it? We were averaging about 6 million people a week, which would still be considered decent on network TV by today's standards, 5 years later. And I went out on the road and I did my set and then I would do my set. And then at the end, I would say, so some of you are here because you watched my show, Cristela. And the crowd would just lose it for the next couple minutes. And you knew that that's why they were there. And I feel like that moment is always very hard to describe to executives. Mm. That when you actually get to be in the room with people that love and support that thing, that is research that you can't show.
Yeah, that connection.
Yes. Yeah. You know, so I was in Fort Lauderdale. I was doing the improv comedy club, and I found out at the show. You know, because people kept asking me, every time I went to a city, people would ask me if the show was coming back. And I would always have to tell them no. Like, I'm not sure, I haven't heard. And that was the night that I said no. And I found out, I do meet and greets after every show and I thank everybody for showing up and everything. And like 10, 15 minutes later, I got a call asking me to do The View.
And this is, so they're saying to you, the same network, we're canceling your baby, the thing that means so much to you and is such a personal story to you, really a love letter to your mother. Mm-hmm. We're canceling that. But we're giving you this other thing because we really like you on this. Mm-hmm. And what was your answer to that? Well, we know the answer. It was ultimately no.
I said no. And people couldn't understand why I was saying no. And I didn't want it. This is a thing that I find very difficult. This is a struggle I deal with a lot in this business. When I say I don't want to do it, I really don't. And
it's not a negotiating thing.
Right. But also, it's not. I don't want to do it for a reason. Mm. And people don't understand that. I think that The View, my time on The View was amazing, and I loved everybody I worked with. The women, I loved being with the women. But career-wise, I wasn't ready to do The View. Hmm. I didn't want to do The View.
If they came back to you now, would you do it?
Not in the version that it's in right now. Hmm. I just, you know, it's when I was on The View, we had moments. You know, we saw a picture where I said it was my favorite episode of The View.
Yeah, we've got that.
And I remember that episode was so great because we weren't really talking about politics or anything. We were having fun. Whoopi had said this funny line, and she said something about being a rapper or something. And then I gave her a beat, and she started kind of rapping, and it was like really funny, and it was on the air, you know, and it was just this, you know, and it was so funny because the audience was just loving that we were living in that moment.
Yeah.
I like that view.
Mm.
I like the view where we can be ourselves and not consistently have to drown people in loud opinions.
Mm. And that seems to be at least what we see publicly, and we're now hearing reports of toxicity, alleged toxicity in the background. I'm going to take a short break and ask you about that and what you witnessed on The View. We'll be back with Cristela in just a moment. Back with Cristela Alonzo. So we were just talking about The View, your time on The View, and recently stories have come out about Abby Huntsman leaving, and the stories around it are there's a toxic environment on The View, in the background, between the people. Did you witness any of that?
The View was very different when I was there. We actually, you know, that was the year that Rosie Perez, Rosie O'Donnell, Nicole Wallace, Whoopi, and I would kind of constantly rotate. Well, you know, I would rotate with them the most. I really loved my time there. Mm. And actually, like, I loved Nicole.
Yeah.
You know, it was actually, for me, when you do The View, you do hair and makeup, and then you do a producer meeting where you just basically talk about what topics you're going to talk about, but you don't really go into detail.
Mm.
So that your opinion is
fresh.
Yeah. I always loved them. You know, it was interesting to me. That's why I did The View so much. I mean, I say I only do things that I want.
Yeah.
I really liked The View. I loved The View. I can tell you that I find it very difficult to watch it right now because you have the memories of what you loved about it, you know, and I always feel like when people come in, energies change because everybody's different. So you kind of have to admit that sometimes certain personalities don't work well with each other. I can tell you that I really loved it.
Mm.
And it, you know, so for me, when I hear reports like that, it feels really foreign.
Let me ask you one more question, and that is having to do with comics.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they always say comics are these tortured souls.
Mm-hmm.
You've been in, you know, comedy clubs your whole life. You've been around a lot of comics. Do you consider yourself some tortured soul? And is this some sort of exercising of that soul when you go down on the stage? Or how would you explain it?
Well, you know, I think that that's kind of a cliche to a certain extent. I think that... for me personally, I can say that I started doing stand-up because my mom passed away, and I wanted to talk about my mom.
Yeah.
So I kind of treated it as therapy.
Mm.
That's why I started stand-up. For me, once I started talking about my mom and started getting laughs about it, I realized that what worked for me in stand-up was talking about problems and struggles I had and making them funny. And for me, what I always want to do with that is I think that's how you trick people into learning about things that they might not want to learn about.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you might not like how I grew up and you might not like what I believe in, but you can't deny that my truth is my truth.
Yeah.
So with me, there's some comics that, you know, go up and they do very like high energy on the surface stuff, and that's who they are and that's what they like. I don't think that necessarily every comic is broken. I can tell you that for me, I don't feel broken. I feel like I have cracks that I like to talk about, mm-hmm. because we all have them.
Yeah.
So for me, I think that the comics that I admire the most are the ones that can hold up a mirror to society and show them what we're really like in a way that doesn't make people angry, but actually makes them think.
Mm. When you do that to yourself, you're so vulnerable, right? Mm-hmm. You're talking about your personal life, your mom, all of these things. And I think most of us think, man, there's no way. I could never do that. I mean, just forget the part about going up and telling a joke and hoping people laugh. And I'm just talking about the revealing of one's self. You do it every time you go on the stage.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. Right now I'm working on my new hour that I want to shoot this year. And I started, a lot of my chunk is actually, talking about my severe social anxiety and my severe depression. Mm. Which goes into a lot of things that might seem very dark for people. But when you're a kid that grew up squatting in an abandoned diner and you had the kind of life I lived, you grow up having to make things funny. My brothers and I have always said that the best time of our lives were living in that abandoned diner, and it's because we made it funny.
Well, we appreciate what you have done for us. We will look forward to this this new bit of depression,
yes.
made funny.
Yes.
What I want to do is continue our conversation on the audio podcast, so I'll invite our folks to come join us on the audio podcast. We'll also ask you some of the questions that they've submitted. So we'll see you there on the podcast. I want to thank you, Cristela, for a wonderful time.
Thank you so much.
All right, and we'll see you next time.